And the Oscar goes to Emma Stone.
La La Land.
On a CBS Sunday morning show, aired shortly before her performance in La La Land, won her the Oscar for Best Actress. Emma Stone remembered how she felt 7 years earlier, after she'd stopped going to high school and moved to Hollywood to focus on her acting. She turned 22 and realized that the people she'd grown up with had graduated from college. It hit her. I'm not an educated person. Then she thought, I took my path. This was my story. This was how my story went. Because recent political events had me thinking about the mindset of people who were not fully educated, I wondered, what is the story of Emma Stone? I figured that watching the movies in which she acted could be a way to find out, so I bought a ticket to see La La Land, and then rented all of the Emma Stone movies available on Netflix. Perhaps driven by a need to redeem her own lack of education, Emma Stone channeled her talent and her ambition to take on the ultimate educational role, a consciousness-raising role. She did this against the background of movies that, though set in high school or in college, did not necessarily sing the praises of education. Take Crazy Stupid Love. Robbie Weaver, played by Jonah Bobo, is the younger brother of Hannah Weaver, played by Emma Stone. His class is studying a paradigm of conventional education, Nathaniel Hawthorne's 1850 novel, The Scarlet Letter. Robbie tells the class that he thinks the book means that love is for stupid assholes. This move gets him called in to see the dean with his mother, played by Julianne Moore. But walking out of this meeting, Robbie's mother isn't critical of her son, and instead wonders out loud, why are they still making kids read The Scarlet Letter? You'd think someone would have written something better by now. Could Robbie's mother have had in mind the story of Easy A, a movie that came out 1 year before Crazy Stupid Love? As its title suggests, Easy A does not extol the virtues of rigorous education. Instead, loosely alluding to Nathaniel Hawthorne's Scarlet Letter, Easy A is the story of a high school student, Olive, played by Emma Stone, who defies the rumor that she's sleeping around with guys by wearing to school on her bosom the Scarlet Letter A. Easy A made Emma Stone a movie star, so when the film's DVD was released, she narrated the DVD commentary about the making of the film along with its director, Will Gluck. At one point during their commentary, Gluck teases Emma Stone that she first discovered what a high school looked like during the shooting of their film. Emma Stone responds, "Why go to high school when you can make a movie about going to high school?" An impudent question, no doubt. But one Mia Dolan, Emma Stone's character in the musical hit La La Land, could also have been asking herself. Mia Dolan is an aspiring actress. After lots of unsuccessful movie auditions and after only a handful of people show up to watch her performance of her play So Long, Boulder City, she gives up on acting and moves back home to Boulder City, Nevada, telling her boyfriend Seb, played by Ryan Gosling, "You change your dreams and then you grow up. And I can go back to school." But Seb convinces her to do one more audition. She gets the part. She'll make lots more movies. She'll become a star. She won't need to go back to school. But not all aspiring actresses follow in Mia Dolan's tracks. In Gangster Squad, Emma Stone played Grace Faraday, who moved to Hollywood to be a movie star. Gangster Squad doesn't go into Grace Faraday's education, but evidently it left her few career options, because when she did not make it in the movies, she shacked up with Los Angeles' most vicious mobster, played by Sean Penn. Grace Faraday confides to Jerry, played by Ryan Gosling, "I came out here to be a star. I figured I couldn't lose. I figured wrong, didn't I?" Career paths aside, one risk of not being educated is that, like an actor speaking the voice of an animal for a talking animals movie, you spend your life in the mind of a juvenile. In one scene of Marmaduke, the talking animals movie to which Emma Stone contributed the voice of the Australian shepherd dog Mazzy, the Great Dane Marmaduke cuts a loud fart, then says, "I know it's juvenile, but it's all I've got, so there you have it." Juveniles also populate Superbad, one of Emma Stone's earliest movies, like Seth, played by Jonah Hill, who learns that his best friend and high school classmate Evan, played by Michael Cera, got admitted to Dartmouth College. Seth only got into the local state university. He tells Evan, "How the fuck was I supposed to get into Dartmouth? You knew I couldn't get into fucking Dartmouth." Getting educated can mean abandoning juvenile friends, like Seth. And it can also mean abandoning juvenile dreams. In the 2008 comedy, The House Bunny, Anna Faris played Shelley Darlingson, who aspires to be a Playboy playmate, but gets kicked out of the Playboy mansion. She then earns a living advising college students about remaking the reputation of their nerdy sorority. For example, helping Natalie, played by Emma Stone, overcome feeling too smart to be attractive to boys. At the end of the movie, Playboy invites Darlingson back to the mansion and asks her to be the centerfold for its next issue. But Darlingson winds up walking off the centerfold shoot. Why? Because by now her new college friends helped her understand why people were calling her vapid. Sometimes becoming educated means becoming educated. In The Amazing Spider-Man, Emma Stone played high school student Gwen Stacy, who's in a relationship with Peter Parker, played by Andrew Garfield. High school classmate by day, Spider-Man by night. In the sequel, The Amazing Spider-Man 2, Gwen Stacy was honored as class valedictorian and gave a compelling graduation speech. A few moments later, Aunt May, played by Sally Field, congratulates Peter Parker by sharing a precept she attributes to his uncle. "Don't just follow the path, make your own trail." Peter Parker corrects her. It wasn't his uncle who came up with this, but Ralph Waldo Emerson. "Well," Aunt May responds, "you really did learn something here." In the 2009 film Zombieland, four persons drive across the country, headed for California, armed with guns, so distrustful of each other that they call themselves by their city of origin, like Columbus, played by Jesse Eisenberg, and Wichita, played by Emma Stone. Why this distrust? Much of the population of the United States has mutated into killer zombies. An allegory, perhaps, for what can happen to a country when its uneducated population is irremediably dumbed down. How did Emma Stone navigate the often bleak educational landscape of her movies? In Woody Allen's Magic in the Moonlight, Stanley, played by Colin Firth, is investigating whether Sophie, played by Emma Stone, is a clairvoyant psychic or a fraud. Stanley is soon smitten with Sophie and confides to her that until now his life felt wary, stale, flat, and unprofitable. Sophie reacts, "That's Dickens." She's wrong. Stanley was quoting a phrase from Shakespeare's Hamlet. When Stanley remarks that Sophie might benefit from more education, Sophie insists, "That's Dickens." Since the movie doesn't reveal that Stanley wasn't quoting Dickens, but Shakespeare, could Woody Allen have written this exchange, not so much for the plot of his movie, but thinking of his lead actress, Emma Stone, already on her way to becoming a major movie star? But if she continued to mistake Shakespeare for Dickens, might continue to feel uneducated. I believe Emma Stone feels this anxiety and is eager to overcome it. A scene in the 2013 animation The Croods captured her yearning. Doing the voice of the prehistoric teenager Eep, when the world grew dark at sunset, Emma Stone called out to the sun, "Please come back tomorrow," evoking her own persistent aspiration for enlightenment. Sure, Emma Stone had her vulgar scenes, like this juvenile segment in Movie 43, and this outburst in Friends with Benefits. But it seems telling that these two scenes involve two of Emma Stone's shortest movie roles, when she co-starred with Jeff Daniels in the 2009 independent film Paper Man. She played Abby, a troubled teenager who strikes up a friendship with a failed author and helps him outgrow his midlife crisis. It wasn't just talent or ambition that drew Emma Stone to this type of role. In an interview during the filming of Paper Man, she said that she felt good being in this film, as she put it, about real life issues that aren't as simple as a makeover or trying to get laid, like my past movies. Emma Stone aspired for a consciousness-raising role, so much so that the characters to whose conscience she appealed were often older or more educated than she. Co-starring with Joaquin Phoenix in Woody Allen's Irrational Man, as college student Jill Pollard, she pleaded with her own college professor to confess his crime. In Birdman, Emma Stone played Sam, the daughter of an aging actor who was once a movie superhero, played by Michael Keaton. Superheroes like Birdman are immortal, but, as the philosopher Umberto Eco noted, they're also stuck in perpetual adolescence, because they cycle through heroic experiences again and again, never coming any closer to death. Birdman can't find a way out of this cycle. Sam tries to help him, telling him, "You're scared to death, like the rest of us, that you don't matter. And you know what? You're right. You don't. It's not important. You're not important. Get used to it." In Ghosts of Girlfriends Past, Emma Stone played Allison, a former girlfriend of famous fashion photographer Connor Mead, played by Matthew McConaughey, who's had many, many flings with women. Allison tells him that trying to get laid is not the key to happiness. A tough sell. Yet, at the end of the movie, Connor Mead agreed that, as he put it, happiness comes from caring about people. As Air Force Captain Allison Ng in Aloha, she warned the military contractor played by Bradley Cooper, "You sold your soul so many times, you won't ever find it anymore," persuading him to scuttle an unlawful satellite launch. In The Help, Emma Stone played college graduate Skeeter Phelan, returning home in the early 1960s to the segregation of Jackson, Mississippi. She persuades black maids to agree to be interviewed for a book she was writing about them, explaining that she hoped people might understand what it's like from your side. People tell me that I'm obsessed with Emma Stone. I'm not. But in a period that's seeing the darkness that rises when society has been dumbed down, I admire her for showing that there's another path, even when one is not an educated person. To continue on her story, she doesn't need my words of encouragement. So I'll close with her own words, the words she spoke for the teenager Eep in The Croods. "Please come back tomorrow."